After understanding the fierce link with epidemics in the last video, I would like to come very specifically to the pandemics, because pandemic is actually not something that is very old. Pandemics is an extremely recent phenomena, and that is because of a very simple reason, that the world was never so connected that pathogens could travel from place A place to place B. So typically, you know, geographical limitations, weather, all these kind of locational factors would keep normal pathogens to you know, limited geographical area instead of them going global. So the history of life has not really seen pandemics, other than one which I have referred to in some other older videos, is that when the world became a Pangaea, all the land masses got connected. During that period, a massive extinction took place. That is probably because of some kind of pandemic conditions that allowed, you know, pathogens to flow from place to place and, you know, create a kind of havoc that we can see today, at least in the case of Spanish flu. But what is happening today as we undergo this maybe second pandemic? Actually, one more is going on, which is HIV pandemic, but you don't feel it because that is a pandemic and not an information pandemic. So even though HIV has killed about 3.5 crore people presumably, and it is a global phenomena, we don't see lockdowns and we don't see the kind of crisis that we are experiencing right now. So COVID is maybe the, I would say, the first pandemic of the modern age. And by modern age, I mean that not the interconnectedness of the geography of the world, where pathogens can travel across the globe in less than 12 hours, but it is the first pandemic in the age of internet. Now, what is happening is that internet is a very funny medium. We are trying to believe that it is an information highway. And obviously, there is enough talk about it being a misinformation highway and the kind of issues that it has. But I would like to point out that it is actually a, what you're seeing around you is not misinformation, but interpretations. So every bit of information is being interpreted by people and, you know, re-uploaded for consumption of the humanity at large. We have versions and versions of every bit of information, and that has created a very unique situation. It is very difficult to know what is true, and this realization maybe in the initial period of internet was not there, because people used to still believe a lot of which was coming on internet. But now just too many conflicting views can flow at you from the internet, so it is very difficult for you to clearly understand a situation. And when human brain doesn't understand a situation, it just has a very standard response, and that is of being scared. So what we have currently created situation is that, you know, we have just infinite number of boogeymans being created across the planet. And this scenario, as I have pointed out in my last video, is basically creating an extremely stressful environment for human brain. So everybody with the slightest, you know, we are now kind of people walking in a dense dark jungle with an imaginary tigers and leopards and lions all around us. So we are getting extremely scared and constantly under duress of you know, these kind of threats that are presumably emerging around us. And that would bring a very new dimension to the way epidemics unfold across the planet. So as we pass through this, we, you know, have now a situation where the entire world has got some idea of what a pandemic is and how all these kind of things have happened, would happen. But, you know, we are not realizing that similar situations have been all around us, but just because we did not know about them, they never created the kind of fear that is there, and they did not allow situations to snowball to the level that they have snowballed today. So I would like to point out that if you just look at the influenza virus, I think if you just look at United States of America, average 30-40 lakh people get infected every year, and 10-15 lakh need hospitalization, and 40-50,000 of them die every year. So if you just look at the numbers, they're scary, but you don't have a lockdown because you don't perceive them. So there is something called societal recognition of an epidemic. And that societal recognition normally came when, something like bubonic plague happened, where people are dying. The people who should not be dying are dying. But when people who are, what happens in case of influenza or what is happening in the case of COVID, actually the predisposed are dying. The old are dying, the comorbid are dying. So society doesn't get jolted if it is not really told about that kind of an epidemic happening around them. So, I'm sitting in one of the maybe hot cities of India where epidemics is raging, Ahmedabad. So I would like to bring one, piece of information from very recent past to point out the kind of issues that, would ultimately be very relevant in the future. So in 2006, Ahmedabad had a chikungunya epidemic. Chikungunya is basically a virus that is, that travels riding Aedes aegypti, a mosquito. So obviously it's not something like influenza or corona, which is, far more infectious and rapidly spreading. But chikungunya managed to have 60,000 cases in a city that is, say, I would say 3 million population in one season, so 2.5 to 3 months. And there was a professor who kind of worked on it and worked out the additionality. That means checking the previous average of deaths and what is the additional number of people died in that period. And that additionality came out to be about 3,000 people. So 60,000 cases, 3,000 people dead, additional people dead. And I don't think it even got a headline. No, it was just in the margins of newspaper. Currently, if I look at the figures of my city of Corona, it is about 3,000 with 100 dead. Plus, maybe it has moved up a bit, but they are nothing compared to that 60,000 and 3,000 dead. But it never became an epidemic because it was not recognized to be. So basically, in a lot of ways, all these epidemics are state of mind. And that is where we have to now, come to a bigger realization that if we keep thinking about these epidemics and keep fearing them, first is that, as I pointed out, the fear itself is a contributor to lowering of the immunity, and it's a self-feeding process. So, we are now probably becoming a paranoid race, which can keep scaring itself again and again and again. And this would mean that more and more pandemics would keep appearing. Ultimately we could reach a state of utter frenzy, and terrorized animals who really can bring a lot more destruction upon ourselves than, what any epidemic can do. So I would like to do another video to understand this, this dimension of, who we actually are and what is this misconception that we are building around, maybe humans themselves and then epidemics, so that we start grasping that, going overboard or becoming more aware or more informed in these cases is not helping anybody. It is just actually making the situation a lot worse. So till and all epidemics should be allowed to be recognized by the society first, then the media second. We are not really realizing that just looking at the numbers, as I said, HIV has claimed about 3 crore people, and I'm sure none of you would recognize it as an epidemic or a pandemic, mainly because it has not become that mainstream as a news item in India. So this is as simple as that. It is all about the state of mind, and the more we can scare ourselves, the worse we can have. So we don't want to go into this, completely phobic state whereby we become so paranoid that we just keep having pandemics till we become extinct. I hope that, this one realization that COVID should bring to people who matter, because people on the street are not going to be able to respond to this dimension. But the decision makers have to recognize the dynamics that is underlying every pandemic of future. Thank you.